I'd like you to have a look at this. Now, here is a model of Drake's ship, the Golden Hind. And we've chosen it not only because it's a beautiful ship, but also because, to us, it represents the West Country. And one of the things we want to do more than anything else is to identify ourselves with the four counties of Devon and Cornwall, Somerset and Dorset. And we sincerely want to produce programs that you will like. And this is where I'd like your help. We don't know what you want until you tell us. And we want you to tell us what you like and what you don't like. And please don't restrict your advice to what you don't like. It's very important to us to know that we are pleasing the majority of the people the majority of the time. Quite obviously, we can't hope to please all the people all the time.
Good evening, and just a reminder about some of our programs later this evening. Following the news, Chief Inspector Lockhart will be trying to solve another case in No Hiding Place. But before that, at 7, we have the West Country's own quiz program, Ordinary People, where there's the chance to win £100.
And that's followed at 7:30 by our new serial set in the Manchester heartland, Coronation Street.
Not an old recording, but it was something which I may well have been saying to you on that first Monday of Westward's life back in 1961. And tonight we look back with some very old friends over the 20 years or so of Westward's existence. The very first announcement, though, wasn't made by me. That came from the station's first chief announcer, the late Guy Corey. But from those early days, we have quite a roll call of faces and people who became your friends.
Michael Piper, now directing news bulletins for ITN. Audrey Reby, still living here in Devon. And Penny Bowles, who went to BBC and is now in London. And how many of you remember Linda Goodman with her impish smile?
Stuart Hutchison, still with us, but busily writing scripts. And then in the mid to late 60s, this young lady appeared.
Time fly. It's 14 years since I made my way down to Westward Television in Plymouth. Made my way being the operative word. I never actually got there. I bought an old banger of a car the day before, and it sort of went wrong, and I ended up in hospital. But I was really overwhelmed by the generosity of the West Country people who'd never seen me, and they sent me cards and flowers and boxes of fruit. It was a lovely way to almost have arrived. In fact, when I was better and was on my way down there, they sent up one of the staff to make sure I got there this time. It was a nice year. When you're in television, you're always learning. And I learned a lot down there. It was a lonely year, too. That's a surprising thing, you know. People always assume if you're in front of camera, you must be leading a fantastic life. But everybody assumes you are, so nobody ever asks you anywhere, and it is quite lonely. What other things do I remember about that year? Oh, that pantomime. I played Cinderella, and it snowed the night before. It would have been cold enough anyway, but that just added to our problems. And we filmed it at Bicton House. Do you know, I've never seen it. I had a weekend off when it was shown, and that was that.
Are we there? Well, are we?
Well, no. You see, this is Pine Junction, and we're supposed to be at Snodley Cliss. There appears to have been some mistake. I'm terribly sorry, Clive.
Oh, God, he's done it again.
Well, let's get out of here quickly. I mean, I'm getting a most dreadful draught in the most extraordinary places.
Now, look here, you got us into this mess. How do you propose to get us out of it?
Andy, darling, we're already late. We'll miss the show.
I really am most terribly sorry. I just don't know where to put myself.
Are you open to suggestions, madam?
Wait a minute, chaps. Pine Junction, that rings a bell. There's a big country house somewhere near here where we're sure to get some help. I know the way. Follow me.
Who would remember Westward without Gus Honeybun and doing all those birthday greetings to the children? I don't think at that time I ever thought that I'd have children or a child of my own. But 1981 was a very good year for me. I went into my own production company. And this is Master Jonathan. So all I can say is thank you very much, Westward, for having me.
We always seem to get the prettiest of girls. Jane Turner, now living in California. Susan Denny, busy with BBC Radio 2. Colleen Gray, tucked away in Cornwall.
Jenny Clulow, living on Dartmoor. Jane Criddle, another local girl who went to Southampton. Helen McDermott, who we still see when she's in Plymouth. And, of course, our Judy, with Locke Shaun now. But let's not forget the men.
Ian Ritchie, the professional part-timer. Our other Ian, sterling of quality. And David, who fought with Gus before battling with the diary and other programs.
All those who've joined with me in keeping you in touch with programs and other events. But the more eagle-eyed among you will have noticed one glaring omission. Yes, that laugh, which means only one person, Sheila Kennedy. Sheila, lovely to see you.
Thank you.
Sheila, among all the multifarious other duties you had to perform while you were here at Westward, you also became known as Gus Honeybun's mum.
Oh,
how
yes.
How did that start? What started all that?
Well, I think that was because I was, you know, the first woman to ever sort of play with Gus, as they say, if I can say that. And I think it just evolved because it was great fun doing Gus in those days. You know, we used to do stories and things like that, and I used to sort of make up little games and things, you know, and ideas of where he'd been during the day. And in fact, he used to be very good because we had a marvellous scheme one year for Guy Fawkes Night.
Yeah.
And we thought, now, what can we do for Guy Fawkes Night, you see? So we had Gus dressed up in bandages and a splint, and he had his arm up, and I think even an ear was in a splint, you know. And he looked absolutely dreadful. And we had all the children writing in and saying, you know, write in poems and tell us how stupid Gus has been, you see, because he'd actually held a firework in his hand. And after that, you know, on the actual Guy Fawkes Night, the accident rates throughout the West Country went down quite a lot, and we were very pleased about that. But he was such fun to be with.
Yes, he was. Well, you were also something of a journalist when our programme information was carried in the journal Look Westward. What sort of things were you writing about in those days?
Oh, darling, they were lovely hints that everybody used to write in. You know, you used to get lovely handy hints for things like recipes and things to put on your face and marvellous things that would make your feet feel better and things like that. And that was all things, really, that people just wrote in and told you about.
Helpful,
you know,
hints for the West Country.
Oh, it was indeed.
Tell me, Sheila, was there ever any part of being a television announcer with which you weren't 100% delighted?
Well, I think, really and truly, I think it might have been to do with newscasting, and I'm sure, you know, lovely Angela, who'll be with us later, you know, will say that it's not that way, but I used to get very upset sometimes about some of the news that we had to read out.
Well, newscasting can, of course, be very exciting, and in a peninsula where water is never far away and where the hills and moorlands attract every type of weather, it's not surprising that many of our news bulletins are centred on the elements.
With gales, storms and floods behind us, the blizzards and general Arctic weather of 1963 came as no real surprise when they finally arrived. And although those conditions did not return for more than a decade, it still only takes one fall of snow to bring the entire region to a standstill and for towns and villages to be isolated and cut off.
The sea, too, brought its dramas as it expended its force and majesty on ships, but nothing perhaps was as brutal as when the Torrey Canyon went down off the Isles of Scilly. And for nearly a month, this story led every news bulletin.
Until that weekend in early 1967, no one could visualize how much horror an oil tanker could contain when tanks were penetrated and oil was allowed to slide sinuously across the sea surface.
Well, that voice comes from one of the first presenters ever to appear on Westward Diary, Kenneth Macleod.
do have something for Sheila, because remember MasterChef, Sheila presented Gus Honeybun. First of all, what do you think that is?
The most delicious carrot. Thank you. I shall treasure it. Treasure it, I will.
Kenneth, if I might ask you, you are Mr. Westward, particularly Mr. Westward Diary, 5 nights a week.
Feel that muscle.
In those early days of Westward, things were very different. Can you tell us a bit about that?
I remember people and faces. I remember coming. I only came down, curious enough, for 2 days. It's been a long engagement and a very thoroughly nice one. And, oh, Peter, that's our floor manager laughing. I came off the train. Dear old Louis Severy, no longer with us, met me at the station, and I was flat broke. Now, we know the technical excellence of David Howarth, Jerry Ewens, the late Bill Howell, and the marvellous, because I think what Westward has always had is the most fantastic technical backup in every way. But we have one man here called Charles Wright, and I said to Charles, I said, I'm absolutely broke, can you give me a sub? And he said, yes, certainly. And I don't think I've paid him back yet. Is he here tonight? No, I don't think he is.
Over the years, what major change do you think has affected you most?
I think that certainly as we've become more sophisticated, we don't get those awful breakdowns we used to have sometimes.
Disasters, you mean? Do
five,
tell.
10, 15 minutes where a film would break and it would go on and on. I remember with Del Cooper once, he was doing something about mackerel fishing, and we lost everything, and we went on, I think, for 25 minutes.
On wet fish?
Yes, he's very good. He knows about fish, you know, Del.
Yes, he does, I'm sure.
He knows about it.
Well, you make it look very relaxed and easy. How do you manage to do this? How do you manage to stay calm in all this welter of things that go on around you?
Particularly feel calm. See, yes. I love you. I do remember, you know, Roger, because the first thing I remember when I came here was that lovely infectious chuckle of yours. Let me hear it one more time. Let me hear it.
Beast.
Well, there are some items, of course, which have caused raised eyebrows, especially in the early 60s, even to the unflappable Ken Macleod. But what was all the fuss about in those early diaries? Today, they may seem commonplace and even not worthy of comment. But back in 1961, nudes just didn't appear on television.
A naturist is a person who likes to be in the fresh air, the sunshine, for the benefit that it does to his body. He is not a nudist.
And what is the difference exactly?
Well, a nudist is a person who wants to be naked all the time. Not exactly an exhibitionist, but one that thinks more of his body than he does of his health.
Yes, well, films like that made the headlines. Well, full frontals and four-letter words were not yet part and parcel of programs. And that was to say nothing of the illegal activities which we uncovered in those early days of the diary.
It really does go on, with no betting tax to pay. A survival from the British countryside of the 18th century.
Well, I think even now cockfighting is liable to send people rushing to their phones to dial 999. But there were the notable events, and there weren't many more spectacular scenes than those which greeted Sir Francis Chichester on his return home.
She's there. Sir Francis has sailed round the world. From the shore, they beheld a great armada heralded by carnival plumes of red, white, and blue. Gypsy Moth reached her own buoy and was made fast. Lights helped to pick her out, and the watchers saw a cheerful wave.
Sir Francis Chichester's homecoming, a recreation of the glory of old West Country sea dogs. But who was Harold Wilson trying to emulate when he held this famous press conference on the Isles of Scilly, also in 1965? It was not really the style of Disraeli, Gladstone, or even Clem Attlee. But through his home on St. Mary's, Sir Harold was a familiar figure in the Southwest, both in and out of office.
Come on,
In 1962, Sir Alec Douglas Hume drew crowds more befitting royalty or pop stars than a prime minister.
Ted Heath, in his Bordeaux trade days, before he went on to bigger things in Downing Street, also made the westward trek regularly.
And there are schools which carry Mrs. Thatcher's name as education minister rather than prime minister.
No West Country year is complete without its royal visitors, and everywhere the crowds.
We've watched the royal family grow from childhood to maturity.
And we've been aware of a great liking for and interest in hats.
And there's always been a warm welcome for Princess Margaret.
And for the West, an equally warm smile from the Queen Mother.
But politics and royalty were not the only subjects. Beatniks and St. Ives dominated headlines in the 60s.
Might as well open butter to interview them.
Do you think that shouting to people they would be better off in dustbins is in keeping with St. Ives?
No, they are probably pink.
You want what they look like? That's all they are.
Do you think that this gives St. Ives a good impression, shouting out things like that?
You no business here.
Why not?
You're in the wrong place. You're in the bloody place.
We're trying to get visitors here, not send them away.
Well, visitors we spoke to yesterday saw no fault with them being here.
What you're trying to do is to blacklist this town to stop good visitors coming here.
I work 46 years in one bloody firm, and they're getting more off national assistance than I'm getting on a pension.
Well, how do you feel life is in St. Ives?
Well, it'd be all right if it weren't for the people turning the swags the way we dress. I mean, I've just been in there and I said, can I have a cup of tea, please, to take away? She says, no, I'm not serving you. I said, well, can I have the reason why? She says, I haven't got a reason.
Tradition and the offbeat have always been part and parcel of the West Country's makeup and character. And man's basic instinct to hunt has also been strong. This desire to hunt manifests itself beyond deer, fox, otter and hare. The conger eel was an unwilling victim on the Bristol Channel coast.
Some reporters have found themselves in most unusual outfits.
I think my head was round the other way before you twisted it.
The unmistakable voice of Clive Gunnell, practicing his walks. And if Kenneth Macleod must be regarded as Mr. Diary so far as the studio work is concerned, then Clive was certainly Mr. Diary out on location.
Let's go to the paper. Walk towards the window.
We must never forget the West's own inventor, the late Mr. Herbert Hayden, a Western Superman.
In case they come any time.
Well, the suit is merely an explanation of why pilots of flying saucers appear like this. Because, you see, they are liable to static charges. Adamski, when he stood by the side of that flying saucer on his first contact with a pilot, wanted to go inside the same as I should, but he got no static suit on, and he was waved away. And as he turned away, his arm just touched the periphery of that saucer, and a static charge hit his arm up and went down, and he lost the use of it for 3 weeks. So I continued.
And at a more mundane level, a boon for cricketers, the painless bat with his springing carried through from the handle to the blade.
Rubber sandwich non-sting bat. The only one in the world, and I'm the only manufacturer that will guarantee a bat not to sting bought from me.
Do you think that'll give every hit a six?
It'll put fours into sixes, sir, if you'll use my bat.
And singles into fours?
Singles into perhaps two, sir. No, we mustn't exaggerate.
Maybe for some matches this year, the England 11 could have done with some of those. Well, we've had a fair number of reporters on the diary since 1961, and in the late 60s, we said hello to a young girl who was known in amateur theatrical circles. We'd seen her work on local newspapers, and she'd done a stint with the BBC in Plymouth. Was she someone who would make a name in the world of television?
And their trousers. In here, it's a bit like the tropics. All I can say is, who needs Tenerife when we've got sunshine like this in North Devon? Good night.
Ah. Here, then, is the lady who first exposed her legs for Westward Diary in 1972, Miss Angela Rippon. Angela, how long were you with Westward Television?
4.5 years altogether, Roger.
And when you first came here, what was your first job?
Well, I was actually employed, as you said, I was with the BBC before. They asked me to come here because Westward decided that they'd like to have a woman's programme. And I was invited to join the company as editor of the woman's programme, which we called Open House, which ran for the entire 4.5 years that I was here.
So it did.
But, Westward was, as it was then, a small station where people were expected to be able to do everything. So although I came to edit the woman's programme, I ended up presenting it, doing most of the reporting and the research on it. And from time to time, I used to purloin the reporters from Westward Diary. So I had a lissom young Stuart Hutchinson working for me, and the Mr. Andy Price. But then we went on to do things like the children's programme that I produced, which was called Young Eyes, which your announcer actually... remind me of his name.
David Rogers.
David Rogers, that's right. He started work on that for me before he went to Westward. And then we did documentaries, three of them.
That's right. Westward and for one Report. Of those documentaries, you actually won an award.
Yes, we won the Silver Medal at the New York Film Festival for a film that I did called Silent Valley, which John Pett, in fact, directed. And I was looking at your awards earlier, and I see that it's missing. So whoever's using it as a door prop, I'd like it back, please. but there were documentaries, there was Westward Report, there were all sorts of things. And if ever the diary editor saw me sitting down with nothing to do, he used to say, would I come and work for him, which was how I came to do that story, which was in North Devon, on the very first sunbed that we ever had here in the West Country.
So you'd say you were a maid of all trades while you were here?
Well, I think we all had to be jacks of all trade. I mean, I think we wouldn't have lasted if we hadn't been.
Thank you very much, Angela. Well, we've got to take a break now, but stay with us for more surprises from 20 years of Westward. Welcome back to part two of a programme designed to bring back a few memories and reflections of the daily potpourri of life, people and events in the West Country. Or as Eric Putnam always refers to it in the Cornish Times, the best country. Closely allied with our major programme, The Diary, has been sport. We may have lacked the Liverpools and Manchester United, and it's only in the past couple of years that Somerset's become a major force in cricket. But all that never worried one of our very early sports editors, David Vine.
Well, down there is Hong Kong, and that's certainly a long way from Home Park, Plymouth, but it's still just as windy. It's certainly a long way from those early days at Westward, but I'll never forget those. I think we're all thought of as slightly crazy in those times, the people who worked on that programme, Sports Desk, the late Don Arnold, my great colleague, and in particular, the Cameron Jerry Ewens. It was the days when Bruce Teller, that wonderful barefoot runner from Inster, was at his peak. Remember doing a feature on Brian Barnes, now one of the great golfers. At that time, Brian was at Millfield School trying to decide whether to be an athlete, a golfer, or a rugby player. But one particular incident I certainly never forget is when we filmed the Cowes Torquay powerboat race. Cameron Jerry Ewens, myself, and a rather mad pilot called Vaughan Hatton from Torquay took off in a little Oster aeroplane, and we were flying around Cowes at very low indeed, because Ewens wanted to get some excellent pictures, and we were going slower and slower. And suddenly there was a rather choking sound, and the whole thing stopped. Apparently we got a fuel blockage. And the only thing I remember about it was the pilot suddenly shouting to me something like, open the doors. Well, the last thing I was going to do was open the doors, but as we got down to about 3 feet above sea level, with no engines running at all, suddenly there was a spluttering and a cough, and we managed to get back up the top again, and nobody said a word for about half an hour. Got some great pictures of the powerboats, by the way. We, in fact, landed at Exeter to refuel to take the last run from Exeter to Torquay, and I made the executive decision. The camera was going with the pilot, and I was going in the coffee house at the airport. He can do the rest of it. But they're all good times. I never forget them. And I think in the days at Westward, I learned an awful lot that it's put me in good stead to go around the world now with other companies. And as they said, you did everything there, from sweep the floor to sign your own expense sheet, which wasn't a lot of good because we never had any money. But they were good days, and as you might say, they were handsome boy. Right, that'll do.
The start of Westward also saw the start of the pop music industry and culture as we know it today. In the early 60s, jiving gave way to twisting, but a more potent pop phenomenon was about to start. That was Beatlemania, and there wasn't a part of the country that didn't suffer and enjoy a visit from the four young men from Liverpool.
Beatlemania and other pop phenomena of the early 60s meant that no self-respecting television company was without its gyrating audience, and for Westward, well, does this voice need any introduction?
Oh yes, nostalgia and spin along on Plymouth, on Westward Television down in Plymouth. Absolutely unbelievable. I remember, as a matter of fact, I've got a little list here of some of the top 10 artists who first appeared on the first show. There was the Temperance Seven, Brooke Brothers, Duane Eddy, Craig Douglas, Connie Francis, Floyd Kramer, Helen Shapiro, to name just a few of them. I remember the director, Pat Lumsden, ringing my then agent, Bunny Lewis, and saying, I've got an idea for a pop show, which was all sort of a bit of a mystery to us then. And he said, I'm going to gather all the artists, bring them down to Westward Television, actually film them. And in those days, it was legal. You could mime. You could play the record and mime. And that was one of the very, very hardest things for the artists to do. However, they got through it. And we used to have this huge party. And all of a sudden, pop stars realized that not only could they come down and perform, but in fact that their record that was just coming up would be released almost nationally on television. And stars came from everywhere. We had tremendous fun. It was a very brilliant idea of the director, Pat Lumsden, who unfortunately has now passed on. But of course, 20 years ago, we didn't quite realize just how the pop industry would blossom out. Spin along, that was really something. They were great days. They're not finished yet.
The swinging 60s were a time for teenagers. Music and fashion were the in things. And one pop song summed up a whole era. Anything goes.
Spin along, the diaries, sports desk, farming, faithful life, the list is almost endless. And to condense 20 years into such a short time is almost impossible. But there were the moments of glory. Emmys, gold, silver and bronze medals from here, there and everywhere, all for programmes running from Wyvern at War through to The Potter's Art, The Loss of the SS Schiller and Tavistock Goosey Fair. All made in the West Country, for the West Country and involving West Country people. And especially involving our guests here tonight. Angela, how do you remember your time here at Westward?
Oh, very happily, without question. I mean, I think that to echo something that David Vine said, we all had to be able to do everything. And I think that since I left Westward, obviously, I've got involved in a lot of other things nationally. But I feel that the time that I spent at Westward was a time when I learnt probably more about television production than I have learnt in all the 14 years I've been in television.
Thank you very much, Angela. Sheila, as the first woman on Westward Television, are your recollections of a happy working atmosphere?
Oh, yes, indeed, yes. It was absolutely marvellous. I think the marvellous thing about it was I came from the theatre and didn't know a thing about television. And the marvellous thing was I could learn about time on the air, and all the viewers really didn't mind. You know, you were sort of waffling away, and the clock would be ticking away, and you thought, yes, yes, you know. Yeah. It was absolutely marvellous. They were lovely to me, too.
Lovely. Kenneth, you were there then, and you're here now. What do you think about it all?
Well, it's just the people, my dear old mates, Stuart Hutchison and Clive Gunnell, we have a common interest in music and Proust, you know, and other passions that we do. I can always remember... Why do you laugh? I do. We do look at that. I love a shot of this.
Proust,
Kenneth. Yes.
Thank you very much. I can see you're having a very happy time. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Well, in 10 days' time, an era comes to an end when the Golden Hind symbol vanishes from your screens. And while we don't want to become too maudlin or self-indulgent, we can't resist looking to the man who made it possible. It was in 1957 that Peter Cadbury started to build up a syndicate of local people and show business experts from London in order to be the first to bring independent television to the Southwest.
We were pioneers in those days, and television was still a pioneering industry. And it was just a few of us who got together, and we set up Westward Television, and We had a lot of fun, and there are so many incidents that would take much longer than this program has time to tell. We had the train, we started with the crazy gang, the Lord Mayor of London, and we set off around the West Country with our special train, and that the object of that was to try to get people to change their aerials so they could receive this new ITV signal, because of course they were all on BBC. Over the next 20 years, I was working with a loyal, enthusiastic, and comparatively small group of people, all of us with the same objective, namely to make Westward the friendliest and the most efficient station in the ITV network, and I think we succeeded. I think that the camaraderie among the staff was reflected in the programming. I think it was reflected in the reception we had from the audience we were serving, the popularity of the people taking part, and everything Westward did was aimed at identifying itself as a part of the West Country, and I think we succeeded. And over the following 20 years, we built up, I think, a reputation second to none in ITV. I have always believed that Westward was the best ITV station. It was certainly the friendliest, and it gave me 20 years of a very happy part of my life, where I made a lot of friends, and many of those people still are my friends. And I wish the successive companies who run Westward all the luck in the world.